Good evening. Welcome to the Maison Française. We are truly very, very honored to welcome this evening Serge and Beate Klarsfeld, who've come to talk with us about their jointly written memoirs, which were published by Fayard and Flammarion in 2015, and which will be translated in English now and will be published by Farrar Straus and Giroux at the end of this year or perhaps the beginning of next year. So thank you so much for making the trip to be here with us tonight at the Maison Française. I'd also like to thank the Knapp Family Foundation and President Charlie Knapp for making it possible to invite them to be here with us this evening. Do those of you who, we have simultaneous translation because the Klarsfelds are going to be speaking in French. So if you don't understand French and want to listen to an English translation and you didn't pick one up on the way in, we have headphones that you can pick up outside. So please go and get one of those if you didn't on the way coming in. I'm just going to make a brief introduction and then turn over to Adam Gopnik, who's agreed to be our moderator and interviewer for the event this evening. Serge and Beate Klarsfeld have devoted their lives to the pursuit of justice against Nazi criminals who had escaped punishment for their crimes, but equally to restoring the memory of Jewish victims of the Holocaust who might otherwise have remained in obscurity. Beate is German, Serge is French and Jewish, and they describe in their jointly written memoirs, and will hopefully share with us tonight, the story of their unlikely meeting as young adults. They became not only partners in a lifelong marriage, but also partners in a remarkable mission they forged outside the bounds of official positions or institutions as private citizens. The working methods they developed, beginning with their very first public action against then German Chancellor Kiesinger, have been creative and often dramatic, and they've shown an admirable capacity to be single-minded, hardworking, tenacious, persistent, and courageous in their mission of holding men accountable for the atrocities they committed in the Holocaust. Beate and Serge have also been equally devoted to restoring the names and faces of victims of the Holocaust, doing meticulous research and writing dozens of books meant to serve as tools of explanation, evidence, and memory. Among their most important publications are a book called The Memorial to Jews Deported from France, which documents the 76,000 names of Jews bound for Auschwitz, listed by train convoy and identified by last name, first name, date of birth, place of birth, and nationality. They've also placed a particular emphasis on children in their work and published in 1996, French Children of the Holocaust, a memorial, presenting through photographs the faces of 2,500 children under age 18, just a fraction of the children who would be deported from France and killed. Beate and Serge Klarsfeld also founded an organization, the Fils et Filles des Déportés Juifs de France, the sons and daughters of Jews deported from France, and formed the Klarsfeld Foundation, which continues its mission of bringing Nazi criminals to justice, opposing crimes against humanity, helping Jewish people resist persecution, and preserving a historic record. Serge Klarsfeld has been awarded the title of Grand Officer of the French Legion of Honor, and Beate is a commander of the French Legion of Honor, and both have been awarded the Order of Merit by Germany. Adam Gopnik has kindly agreed to interview Serge and Beate Klarsfeld this evening. He's, of course, a brilliant writer for The New Yorker magazine for many years and the author of a number of wonderful books, including Paris to the Moon, The Table Comes First, Family, France, and the Meaning of Food, and Winter, Five Windows on the Season, among others. Adam is also a lover and connoisseur of French history, literature, and culture. He lived in France for 5 years, where he wrote for The New Yorker, and he was awarded the Medal of the Chevalier by the French Ministry of Arts and Culture. So please join me in welcoming our very special guest.
Serge, Beate, welcome to New York and welcome to Columbia. I know it's not your first visit, but we're very proud and honored to have you here with us. As I was saying before, this is a remarkable book. And please, everyone, we're going to try and, as Shani was explaining, we're going to conduct this evening in a bilingual spirit. One of the remarkable things about the Klarsfelds' history is that they are very much a Franco-German couple. There we are.
The books.
Yes, the books arrive at last. They always arrive at the last minute. Thank you. And I won't inflict my bad French on you tonight. I will speak in English about a beautiful book written in beautiful French, and the Klarsfelds will respond in French. This book, in addition to being a story of justice and a story of a mission in life, is also a love story, and that's one of the things that makes it a very beautiful book. It's written in a contrapuntal style. So first Beate speaks, and then Serge speaks, and we go back and forth between the two voices to great effect and in a very moving way. So before we go, we plumb back into the into history, into where your own personal connections with the history that you did so much to reveal and expose begins. I did want to ask you to tell us something about that remarkable meeting in the metro, I believe, in 1961, if I have the date right. 1960. When a young Frenchman in a Prince of Wales suit saw a charming German girl.
Such a long time ago.
And we look more like this at this time, you know.
But you were, it was, yes, in the correspondence, right? In the,
yeah.
Yes, we, but I took the metro like every morning to go to Sciences Po, and I saw a nice young girl with Alliance Française, the book of Alliance Française. So I tried to have a relation with her, and she looks very nice. That's all.
But
and it was the same day as Eichmann was kidnapped in Buenos Aires, the 11th of May 1960. And so I spoke. I believe that she was a German, yeah. But I asked her, "Are you English?" And she replied immediately, "No, I am German." And so we could start to speak, and she gave me
a phone
number, and she was au pair girl in Paris, and so we started half a century or more of common life, and we, at the same time, we made exceptional things and have a completely normal life. With children, with two dogs, with two cats, and one cat just
hit
my eye. But so it's a normal, completely normal life, like people working together. But we always worked together, and we were happy not to have separate lives, but to have. I believe that enforced mutual love to be together always, and because life it goes so fast that to be with people that we love is good. We meet our girl. We have a daughter each day, and our son also each day. We were never victims of what we did, and we were happy as when we compare reading books and meeting people, we surely were and are very happy. And that's also a strength, to be happy, because we could do in the world of Holocaust, where we meet so many people who suffer. If you are unhappy, you are weak, and if you are happy, you are very strong, and you can do things that you do not believe that you can do.
Yes, And that's one of the things that makes
And I spoke in English.
Very well, thank you. Very beautifully. Beate, you spent the war years in Berlin,
yes,
and you're with your father away.
And my father was, he went to the army quite immediately, right. And so I stayed in Berlin with my mother, and then our apartment was bombed, and we had to leave Berlin to see, to live in a, with parents outside of it. First we went to different places, and also I went to a cousin, an aunt. Her husband was a Nazi, and he was in a place in Poland, in Litzmannstadt. Mm-hmm. How it's in English, Litzmannstadt, a lodge. So I have pictures at this time. I'm in a lodge with my mother and the Nazi. And then we returned back to the place, and we had several family members where we stayed, and in 45, when Germany was occupied, the part where we had been in Havelberg near to Berlin, that was taken by the Russians. Mm-hmm. So I saw the Russians arriving, and my father, who had been in the army, he never had been a high-ranking officer, and he had the chance also not to be sent to Russia because he became a pulmonary. Yes. So he was in the hospital, and then he finished his work in the army in an office. So 45, he was arrested by the English, by the British. So, I had a lot of friends in school. When the teacher asked, how is your family and so, and quite a lot said, my father, I lost him in Russia because a lot of German soldiers. So I had the chance, he was arrested by the English, and in 45, a little one, he came to see us where we had been evacuated, and he returned to Berlin. And so
you write very movingly, too, about the amount of time you spent, this is before the wall went up, in East Berlin in your girlhood, in the eastern half of Berlin, that you loved to wander there and walk there.
Oh, yes, because, and when I left Berlin before the wall was constructed, so I had, even later I could go from one. But at this time, I had my friends and cousin, family was living in East Germany, in East Berlin, and we were living in West Berlin. So for me, it was normal to go from one place to another. And also, as a young girl, it was very poor. There was not a lot to eat. The Americans sent us the food, you remember when. With my friends, we were playing in ruins in Germany, in Berlin. But I had always, and this time it was not a city more or less down in my mind, but I had seen in Berlin was completely ruined. My father was working also on the chantier. But also as I went to one place to the other, I had the feeling at this time already that it's one Germany, it's Berlin, I'm here and I'm there. I loved Unter Linden, and so I had at this time prepared to be, that Germany is an unity, and and then when I left Paris, they cut Germany in two parts. But I also had the chance, to see what happened. This prepared me too. At this time, in Germany, in school books and the teachers didn't speak about the Holocaust, neither about the Second World War. So for us, we didn't know anything about. But still it was, I had to live in a city where it was in ruin and it was poor and nothing to eat. So this perhaps a preparation for my engagement later,
Yes, and then you went to Paris for the first time, and you write about it very movingly because you were an instant Francophile. You loved, even though you were working as an au pair, but you loved your experience in Paris.
Oh, well, at this time, when I was not very happy about my job in a pharmaceutical company, and also my mother said, you have to marry one day, mm-hmm. and you will have children. But anyway, there was something I was missing, I wanted to learn French and also to see something else and to stay in Berlin. And so I decided just when I was 21, because the parents couldn't say you are not allowed to go, so they were not so happy to see me going to Paris because this is a vacation for a young girl.
And your father, you mentioned this.
And so I decided immediately when I was 21 to, I had the chance also that a friend of mine, she has been au pair in London, and she came back and said, I will go to Paris. So I said, if you are going to Paris, I'll come with you. She had already a boyfriend in Paris. So we went together, and a couple of days later, I had the chance.
You took the metro, and with the results, the results we know. Serge, your Beate's life obviously was crucially affected by the war, but your life was immediately affected by the Shoah, by the Holocaust, and in a very dramatic way. And one of the most dramatic scenes in the book is about hiding.
La question.
Yeah, the question was
that you were. I just was thinking of the moment when you were hiding in the closet with your mother.
Oh, you know about the arrest.
About
the arrest and.
Yes.
Yes, I was one of the 70,000 Jewish children who, during the war, were. Not hiding, being with their family. Some were hiding, and some were living normally with their family and knowing that at any time they could be arrested together or separately. And but I was in a way lucky because we were in the free zone. In the free zone until August 1942, there were no systematic arrest of Jews, except Jews from Germany from Austria. And those who were in irregular situation, who were put in camps. And my mother, my sister, and myself, we left Paris happily because Romanian Jews, we were Romanian at that time. I was born in Bucharest, and Romanian Jews were arrested on the 24th of September 1942. Arrested in the morning. The next morning, about 1,000 of Romanian Jews were deported to Auschwitz, and they were killed 72 hours after being arrested in their bed in Paris. So it went very fast with the French state helping the German state. It was very fast. But we were not in Paris at that time. We were in the free zone in Nice. And my father escaped. He was a volunteer in the French army. And after the battles of La Somme, he was prisoner. He escaped. And we went to Nice. In Nice, in August 1942, they did not arrest Romanian Jews, so we went on living normally, and then Italian army took the responsibility of the southeast of France, and the Italians protected Jews with a great great authority against Vichy. And no Jews were arrested in that area occupied by Italians. And unhappily, on the 8th of September, there was an armistice between Italy and the Allies, and immediately the Germans occupied Nice and the area, and started very cruel arrests of Jews everywhere. But they did that without Frenchmen. The French police did not intervene at all to arrest Jews. in that circumstances. And Brunner, who was the right hand of Eichmann, led the operations in Nice. And my father saw that it was very dangerous to escape from Nice because there was a control of the trains and controls of the roads. So he decided to build a false wall in a deep closet. And we made repetitions how to
rehearsals, right.
Go inside and to remain silent and to make the bed and to take the clothes. And on the 30th of September, the block of buildings where there were quite many Jews was surrounded by the German army, and the Gestapo started apartment by apartment to either they had information or they asked documents. But when they went into the apartment of our neighbors, so they knew that they were Jews, and they started to beat the girls who were our friends in order to know where was the older brother. And so it was awful to hear the family shouting, police française, police française, au secours, sauvez-nous. And my mother, my sister, and myself, we were inside, and my father waited for the Germans. A few days before, he told us, if we are arrested, I will survive because I am strong, but you will not survive, my mom, my mother, and the children, you will not survive. So be silent in the hidden place. And my sister and I, we understood well, and we remained silent in spite of the fact that we were always fighting one with another. We remained silent, and even my sister had to cough, cold, a so she put in her mouth, she put stuff in order not to make any noise. And we were like that. And my father opened the door when the ring rang, and they told, where is your wife and children? And he told that there was a disinfection of the apartment, and that we went to the country, right. And they didn't ask where. So he was strong, and they perhaps didn't want to fight with him, so they didn't ask him where we were. And they started to look in the apartment, if we were in the apartment. And they opened the closet, the door, and they put all the clothes like we heard, we didn't see, we were behind. But they didn't touch the false wall, and we survived. My father left with them, and we remained the whole night hidden. And in the morning, we could go down and started during a few months to try to escape the Germans, because sometimes the Germans started to block one street or to go in a bus and to ask the documents. So my mother, who had a Russian accent, walked on one side of the street, and we on the other side, and we had instructions where to go. And after a few months, my mother was depressed to move from one hotel to another one. And we came back to the apartment, and she said, if the Germans will come, I will open the door. You will be in the hidden place. And happily, the Germans did not arrive. And then we could leave to another part of France, La Haute-Loire, where that also had an importance for my judgment about Germans. There was no Gestapo in Haute-Loire, in Le Puy, and the major, the German major, was a teacher, a French teacher in Germany, and he didn't do anything against Jews. So I had the example of a good German. And when Le Puy was liberated, some Germans, some Jews, including my mother, came to Le Puy in order to know what happened to the German.
Right. Good guy.
He was not mistreated, but his French girlfriend was killed by the resistance.
But your father, Serge.
And
your father, Serge, was deported and died in
Auschwitz.
My
father was sent to Drancy, the camp, gathering camp of Jews. And then he was sent to Auschwitz. And when he arrived, he beat a capo.
Right. Who had struck him.
And was sent to a reprisal commando in the mines in Fürstengrube. And after 6 months, he was selected by the German engineers when he was unable to work and sent back to
Birkenau and
to Auschwitz to the gas chamber.
And it's an extraordinary.
And we waited for him a long time.
You believed that he would have survived, and
we believed he will survive because he escaped from his camp, and so, but he didn't come back, and we
never saw him.
We started, but I was also lucky because I kept my mother, and many children in France lost their mother, their father, and sometimes brothers and sisters. And also, the great majority of Jews were arrested by French uniforms. So they had a wound in the heart because French uniforms came to arrest their family, and they had to wait until President Chirac and 1995 to hear the French president recognizing the responsibility of France,
the French state,
in the arrest, because he in the free zone and in the occupied zone in 1942, more than 40,000 Jews were arrested exclusively by French policemen.
There's so much to talk about in this book, and we could take hours and hours. I want, if I may, to kind of race ahead a little bit to a moment, because the two of you got educated and then got married. You were working for the television for ORTF for those years, and then elsewhere making documentary films. You were working, I think, for Franco-Allemand youth. Exactly. And then there's a particular moment, the 30th of August, 1967, that you write about, Beate, in the book, about, and I thought it was very remarkable, this passage particularly, when you suddenly, well, a crucial moment of change for you, a moment when you had a different sense of mission. Could you talk about that? When you, it's particularly talked about how certain images came back to your eyes when you were trying to make a crucial decision about what you wanted, whether to pursue.
You know, when I met Serge and then And you know, he had friends who were a little one suspicious to that he had a German girlfriend, and some said you have to, and even when he wanted to marry, he said don't marry this girl. But as you say, said Serge, he was a Schmeling who was in Chambon-Solignon, who didn't arrest the Jews. And Serge said, you know, you're a German, and but there had been Germans, as you know, he said, Thomas Mann, who sent from radio in London. And I also, Serge said, you know, you had in Germany the White Rose with Hans Josef Scholl, and they in Munich, they went against the Nazis, distributed leaflets, and they and the brother and sister and the professor around were arrested and killed by
decapitated.
So this was for him, you know, that not all Germans are guilty. And I also, you know, as I arrived in France, and now with help of Serge, who had studied history, I learned a lot. I took books and documents in order to know what happened really between 39 and 45. So I became aware that to be German, you know, is not to be guilty because of Hans und Zwischol, but there is a kind of special responsibility to assume, because if you're German, you want to do something for your country. And now I know I did a lot for Germany, but there was the will to do something. And so I was prepared more or less. And the start was in 63. I went to the French-German news office created by Adenauer and de Gaulle to exchange the news among both countries. And when in 66 in Germany, Chancellor was elected, who was a radio propagandist. So this was a moment where Serge said, you know, you're a good German and you have to respond to assume your responsibility. So we have to do something. And this was, I said, the breakthrough, you know, the articles in the newspaper, the left newspaper combat, where I said, you know, as a German, I cannot tolerate that Germany's so few years after the war can select Nazi propagandist as chancellor. And there are men like Willy Brandt who fought against the outside. And I wrote articles, and from on the third one, where I said Kiesinger had a good reputation in the right in the ranks of the Braunhemden and the Chemise Brune and the Christian Democrats. And I would prefer a man like Willy Brandt. And so he was fired from the French-German news office, you know. This was surprising. So this was also the beginning that we said, they asked me if you want to take back the article. Like, no. So this was the beginning where we started to, my responsibility helped sure by France. And in order to get first a documentation about Kiesinger, Serge, as an historian, went to East Germany. We put documents from Alexandra from Washington. So this was the beginning, you know, but we were not prepared to do this. It's only because the Germans said it's not good to have a Nazi as a chancellor, fired from the Wehrmacht French-German office without reparations from one day another, as have I stolen, you know, something. I was, and nobody from the French-German new office would say, poor Beate, you were right. And even they learned then in the German part of the administration, there were Nazis, you know, they were put away. But there was nobody at this time who would say, but Beate, you're right, you know.
So you had to, and this led, that moment of beginning, led to the slap heard around the world, the gift heard around the world.
It was.
Can you tell us a bit, I'm sure some of the young people in the audience may not remember that as clearly as.
As I said, we tried to put the documents together, and we sent them to the parliament, journalists, and in order to make, because when he was selected, when he was became chancellor, very few newspapers, I think was the Figaro perhaps, and even in Israel, you know, nobody took care of it. It was normal after the war, you know. You had the Nazi criminals and all the functions, Minister of Foreign Affairs, the first parliament, I think they were still in Germany, in West Germany, there were 120 former Nazis, you know, and then you had them all the functions, Minister of Foreign Affairs, the judges. So the for the
and American intelligence used them as well.
Yes. They had been, as we had, as I said, after the separation, when Germany was divided, we had the capitalist world and the Russian world. And I remember that my parents were never thought about the victims of Nazi Germany, but they immediately after the war, the enemies became the communists on the other side, you know. So, and this was also a help. The Cold War was a help to denazify the Germans, you know. So, and anyway, the Chancellor was a Nazi, so everybody who was in the party has not to feel guilty. Right. And so we had to find out how to break, and how the slogan was Kiesinger to ask to resign. It was not easy. So with all the documents, the books we published and the documents we sent out to the journalists, to the members of parliament, but nobody was, you know...
responding.
No, that was not a problem at this time for Germany. And so we had to find manners in order to make public that the Chancellor is a Nazi, and the first was an interruption in the German parliament in Bonn at this time, where from the tribune of the guests I shouted when he was speaking, Kiesinger Nazi design. I was arrested, but still went back in the evening to Paris. But what happened, the newspapers for the first time described his past, so this was...
Good.
And so we continued, and then when there was a big congress in West Germany, I had belonged to the leftists in Germany, so they were wanted not to have this congress in Germany, in West Berlin, and we thought this is a moment in order to, Kiesinger was there, to find a way to slap him publicly. So it was not easy, you know, the slap to be prepared, that was for the whole week, and there was a reception in the Hilton Hotel, but he was sick, he couldn't come. There was a big one in the Hasenheide, it was impossible to approach him. And the last day, I had also the help of a photographer to whom I told, you know, he gave me some, also we had a card from Serge, Compass, the newspaper where he worked, and from the French television, and Compass too. And then the journalist also gave me a card, and he brought me into the Congress Hall, and finally, this last day, when Kiesinger prepared his speech, I had the chance to enter, and it was a big room, the podium at the tout en bas, you right. know, it was
down below
and very, the, very, the table was 2 meters large, so in order to slap him from the front, it was impossible, he had to go behind. And
you said to the security guard, I'm just on my way.
The journalists were staying upstairs. Right. I said, I'm going down and you will follow me. And so I had the chance to pass behind. And when I stood behind Kiesinger, and so he returned because he met that somebody was behind him. I slapped him and seeing Kiesinger Nazi. So this was a moment. And I think this was a moment where his career, I fought against him because it was candidate against him. But it was a moment, I think, which has broken the silence about his past. You know?
With a loud smack.
With a loud smack. Yeah. And it was also the slap of, because as I said, I was supported by the youngsters, the left in Germany, the opposition extra parlementaire. So they also, when I started to meet them and say, helping me against Kiesinger, they also were, you know, didn't want to erect because for them, there were so many German Nazis in Germany, so why to concentrate on the Chancellor? But then the same day, I was sentenced to one year of jail without suspension.
That same day, yes.
The same day, it was also not because a couple of weeks before, the leader of the German youth, Rudi Dutschke, was slapped by a neo-Nazi and wounded, and he had 200 marks
right.
off.
So, right.
Yeah. So fine, this was weird. And then Serge came immediately to Berlin and we went to the university, and when we came in, this was the Congress of the Slap.
Yes, it was also the year when Martin Luther King and Bobby Kennedy were killed, and the bodyguards of Kiesinger
they're sitting in the first row
took their guns in order to shoot,
but I was behind Kiesinger,
One of my favorite details is that though they had to release you that day, that you did still have to publish the a report in the German papers, but that Kiesinger came to regret this publication because it said explicitly that you had you had struck him as because he was an ex-Nazi.
No, Kiesinger didn't want. He didn't want in the beginning to pursue me, you know. But
right.
He was.
But he decided.
He decided because he was because the other politicians around him. So he decided.
To, that he had to. That he.
He yeah, was okay. He right. Party planned. Yeah, sure. But.
But we. I asked my.
Yeah.
My professor of international law, Madame Suzanne Bastide, who was a very high level, if our idea was a right one, because I told to Beate, if you slap the cancer in a foreign country, you will go to jail because it's a foreign country and it's an insult to the country who welcomes the German Chancellor. If it is in Germany, you will also go to... So the only city in the world where you can do it with a chance not to go to jail is Berlin, because Berlin is under the statute of occupation, and you are French by marriage, you are my wife, you are French. And when Beate was sentenced to 1 year jail without suspension, so she told, if you do not give me suspension, I will make an appeal to the French governor in Berlin, and we will see if the French nationality is not stronger than the German nationality. And Madame Bastide told, you are right, and
it
was right, and they released Beate without going to jail, yeah, as she had to do during 1 year. Without Beate during 1 year, it would be... We had a child, and we never wanted to be victims of what we did. So,
no, that's Arno was 2 years old then, or
he was 3 years old.
Yeah. And he came for the appeal. He came with us to Berlin to the, and we took him to Berlin for the appeal.
Oh yeah.
That was the began your public career, when people began to associate you with the hunt for ex-Nazis and with the conscience of Europe, with trying to make people remember and be aware of what had happened between
not them. But also to expel the Nazi from the
political
life
in Germany.
In Germany.
Yes.
And because Beate told, if it was Schiller, who was Minister of Economy, who was Chancellor, it would be the same, you know. And so, that was the beginning of the end of the Nazi
open presence,
activity in the politics at the highest level. And also, Beate made the campaign for Willy Brandt. And, the election of Willy Brandt was for Europe very, very important, because he was the first chancellor to recognize the first prime minister to recognize the borders, to recognize the crimes, and that was the start of the reuniting Europe, because it opened the door to the eastern countries to be closer to the public opinions and so on. And so it was a great luck for Europe that Brandt was elected, and Schmidt after. And so during 10 years, Germany started to be really a democracy.
You became extremely well known for your pursuit of Nazi criminals who had escaped justice in Europe. And perhaps the most famous was Klaus Barbie, who had been in Lyon and had been directly responsible for the death of Jean Moulin and other resistors. That involved an extraordinary kind of detective work, of searching out and discovering
his real identity, where he had hidden in South America. I wonder if you could tell us some of that story and how you two private citizens were able to
It's a very, very long...
No, but in any way, Philip, finally, I think when we, you know, I would add also, when Brandt became Chancellor, and the first...
There was a campaign also
because he made a... There was a coalition with the Liberal Party, and so he had to give something to the Liberal Party, and there was somebody whose name was Ernst Achenbach, who was sent to be commissaire in Europe, in the European community. And we had already his when Serge searched in the documents about Kiesinger, we saw the name of Achenbach, who was at this time.
Yes, so Achenbach was
political.
It's a question of politics, German politics, but you had the Social Democrat Party. Mm-hmm. Made an alliance with a rightist party, FDP.
Liberal Party.
FDP. And the other, the third one party was Christian Democrats. So in the question of Nazi criminals, the Liberal Party, FDP, was an ally of the Christian Democrats against Willy Brandt, who was the Chancellor. So we had to make a campaign, a long campaign, 8 years campaign, because the Nazi criminals who deported the Jews from France could not be extradited from Germany because they were Germans, and they could not be sentenced in Germany because Germany didn't want to sign an agreement with France. And Willy Brandt signed the agreement with France, but the two other parties, the Liberal and the Social and the Christian Democrats, told that they will never ratify that agreement and make a law with that agreement. So we started, Beate and I, only together to make a pressure on the political German society in order to obtain the ratification by the German parliament of that agreement. So, and we started with a spectacular, I would say, actions like attempt of kidnapping and bringing to France the head of the Gestapo in France, Kurt Lischka, and gradually, the generation of the son and daughters of Jews deported from France gathered around us, and we could demonstrate many times in Germany with hundreds of people and obtain, eventually, after being in jail several times, and our friends also, we could obtain the ratification by the parliament of that French-German agreement and get the gratefulness of the official circles in France.
And they all were living under their own names, you know. It was, as you ask, it was not detective work. We had known that Lischka was... in 1939, he was the chief of the Gestapo in Cologne, then he was prisoner, but he came back in after the war to Cologne.
These Nazi criminals were in Germany, and some of them were very respectable. You know, the head of the Gestapo in Paris, Dr. Heinrich Ehlers, he was a man who chose the hostages to be killed in Mont-Valérien. And then he directed the camp de Compiègne and even sent the last trains without German orders. And Dr. Ehlers, we've discovered him president of the Tribunal of Social Affairs in Lower Saxony, and being specialist of the problems of war victims. And it yes. was the same for another one, Dr. Laub, who was head of the killings in Mont-Valérien. And he became president of the Tribunal of Social Affairs of Bad Württemberg. And it was all the headquarters of the Gestapo in France were in a very good position, very high position. And so it put an end to their career, of mm-hmm. course. And nobody among the victims could believe that the people who were the killers will become normal and even higher than normal Germans in the German society. And the trial of the three most important, Kurt Lischka, who was a former head of the Department of Eichmann, and Herbert Hagen, who before the war created was the head of the anti-Jewish department of the SS, and was the man who created the team of Eichmann, Daneker, Wislicheni, all the team of the final solution. He was in France during the war. He was the right hand of the head of the SS and the police, the German police, Karl Oberg. And Heinrichson was a young deputy of the anti-Jewish department of the Gestapo. So the trial ended very well, very positively. We sent thousands of young Jews from France to be witnesses of that trial in Cologne. The trial lasted 3 months. And eventually, they were sentenced. They went to jail. That was the first trial which ended very positively for France, for Germany, and for Israel. And meanwhile, we discovered, not Barbie. In Germany, but in South America, we discovered Klaus Barbie, who was the emblematic head of the Gestapo of Lyon, because he arrested Jean Moulin, and he tortured Jean Moulin, who died some days after. And also he arrested the home of Jewish children, Les Enfants des Yeux, voilà. That, the children of his yeux. And so he was a killer in the on the side of resistance and on the side of Jews. And we discovered him in South America. Okay. And Beate went several times in
a campaign, yeah.
So campaign. She can tell about.
Yeah, because when Serge brought from the Jewish documentation center, there was a paper saying there were some resistance fighters in Germany who had known that Klaus Barbie was, I don't know, not a man in German, but he had asked to mettre inculpé. And for the fact that he deported the 40 Jewish children and he killed the resistance fighters in Lyon and Montluc. So at this time he was not allowed to the German justice was not because the treaty was not ratified mm-hmm. in for the three others in Bonn. So but still the case came to a prosecutor in Munich and he decided by himself, you know, to show that Barbie is not guilty because there is no proof that he had known the death of the 44 Jewish children, and when he executed the resistance fighters, there were no eyewitnesses. Yeah. So Serge brought this document, and we saw I translated it too, and then we started to see what can we do
to try to prove that subjectively he knew.
He knew.
that the fate of these children, will be a fatal fate. And I found witnesses who could prove that, and the case was reopened in Germany, and a German who lived in Lima,
in Peru,
relations
right.
with us, saying that my neighbor who came from Bolivia is looking very much to the photo which appeared in the German newspaper. And I believe he is Klaus Barbie, and he lives under the
assumed
name of Klaus Altman. So we started, investigation in order to compare when he was born, when
his children
wife
were
was
born.
Children, and with the help of German justice.
He found his mind, and he said, if you know, can you prove that he was knowing about, I will reopen the case. So.
And we had the proof. Beate went to
Lima, where he was living at the time.
It was 45 years ago. It was not today.
Whatever, you know.
45 years ago.
And when
it was not like today, but Beate went, and it was a dictatorship,
but first
Bolivia.
I went to first to Lima, but,
yes, it was,
but in Lima, when I arrived,
he went to Bolivia
because he was a Bolivian.
And Beate came back, was arrested, was liberated. Yeah.
And I also had two Jewish mothers who helped from Mrs. Benedict
and
Helen Brunner.
We lost three children.
Yeah.
And then we tried to kidnap Barbie
on the Eichmann
to bring him through Chile to France. Made the operation with Régis Debray, who is a French philosopher, who surely you have the books in the Maison Française, and also with a friend of Régis Debray, Gustavo Sanchez Salazar, who was close to some Bolivian officers. And I went to Chile, and with Regis, we took a small plane, and we went to the border of Bolivia, and we met officers. I gave them some money to buy a car, and they tried to organize the kidnapping of Barbie, and unhappily they didn't succeed. Barbie escaped, and Chile was closed because Pinochet took the power. Allende was killed himself, and so we remained in relations with Bolivia because we had an au pair girl. And we sent the au pair girls to Bolivia we bought her very nice dress and shoes and so on. And she went to the German club and met somebody, a German. And a few days after, she had dinner with Klaus Barbie and become acquainted with the family and came back, and we knew what were the intentions of Barbie, to escape from Bolivia or not. And one day, somebody came to us in Paris and said, I'm a Bolivian. He said, I will kill Klaus Barbie. So God bless you, go.
No, we gave the money to buy her now.
A few weeks after, we paid
the ticket to go back to Bolivia.
A few weeks after, he called us and told, no, I changed my mind because there is a possibility of the end of the dictators. And that was the case. And Régis Debray was, at that time, special advisor of the French president, François Mitterrand. And our friend Gustavo Sanchez Salazar became head of the police in Bolivia. So he arrested Barbie, and he put Barbie in the plane. It's complicated, but the
eventually he
operation
was
made.
And he was brought to justice finally.
And Barbie arrived in Lyon, and Robert Badinter, whose father was arrested by Barbie, and who was Minister of Justice, put Barbie in the same jail in Montluc as the victims of Barbie. And then the trial took place 4 years after, and Barbie was sentenced to life imprisonment and died in jail. That's the story.
It's extraordinary.
Very, very few escaped to South America. All of them had remained in Germany.
Yes, that's the true point. I want to turn the conversation over to this audience, because I'm sure many people have questions, and I could sit here all night and talk. But I did just want to ask you one thing quickly, Serge, about something you write that's very moving, about your own feelings about a Jewish identity, that your sense
about
of being Jewish,
about
your identity coming from the background of the Holocaust and then also the experience of Israel.
I'm not a believer at all. So the only time I was religious, it was during some weeks in Saint-Julien-Chapteuil, a village where I went to the church. So, in fact, I was a Catholic during some weeks or some months. And I'm like completely. But I am not Jew by culture, because I don't know Yiddish, I don't know Hebrew, and I didn't read all the books of Jewish culture. I am a Jew from the Shoah because I was, my destiny, my father, and so many friends. My life is with all these people. I identified all the Jews, each Jew who was deported. I copied so many documents and so on. So I am a Jew by one side of my personality, but not completely Jew. But I am at the border of the
Jewish organizations.
Not inside. You know, the Jewish people is going from one generation to another one by the religion and the culture. But people like myself and my family, my wife is not Jew, our children are not, they don't know exactly if they are Jew or not.
No, my daughter's married to an Italian, you know.
But our son is Israeli because I am Israeli, and
Beate also became Israeli
also.
Last year I became the nationality.
But
so
it's because the Israeli government gave us the nationality as a gratefulness for what we did. And so it's full of contradictions.
So is life in that way. Let me turn it over to you, please, if I may. And gentlemen here.
Your contribution is extraordinary, but I think one can appreciate it even more if one points out a contrast. I'm Viennese, and I was in Vienna when Hitler came to power. And when you look at the history of Austria compared to Germany, it's like day and night. Austria denied at the beginning, denied in the middle, denies now. It lacked people like yourself. It really pretended all along that they had nothing to do with anything, they were victims. And it really wasn't until 1990 that the Chancellor for the first time admitted that they also contributed to the Holocaust. What you did in Germany was extraordinary, because the tendency to deny is so great
that if you can get away with it, as the Austrians were able to do it, even to this day, they don't completely admit it.
No, we campaigned in Austria, we campaigned very much, you know. We were, when Walter
campaigned very so often
against Walter, you know. We tried
were arrested in Austria, Beate campaigned against Waldheim, against
Haider,
against Schirmer against Waldheim, against Haider, against...
No, we had been very, with our group, the sons and daughters, he had been arrested, and I remember when there was, he was twice Secretary General of the United Nations, Waldheim, you know. And by the way, when I was invited last year to make a speech in the United Nations, I said, you know, I campaigned in Vienna against Waldheim, and the archives had been here downstairs, you know.
Thank you. So. Thank you for your comment. Lady back here. Stand up if you would.
Je vais poser ma question en français, si c'est possible.
Voilà.
J'aimerais savoir ce que vous pensez de l'interdiction des voyages et de l'immigration des musulmans. Est-ce que vous y voyez un danger, pas seulement pour les États-Unis, mais pour le monde entier?
Did everyone understand the question? It's about the recent ban on refugees
and
on the seven countries that... hard to say, Mr. Trump, put over.
There is a wave of populism in the Western world. In Europe, in each country in Europe, you have extreme right party, and also the public opinions, they are confronted with... a wave of immigration, you know, and very strong and very fast. And when it's strong and fast, people don't like such changes. And you have also countries in Europe where they fought during 40 years to keep their national identity. So now they don't want to lose their or to have their national identity being mistreated by arrival of many foreigners. The countries with prosperity like Europe, millions and millions of people want to arrive. You are not in a world of the Second World War or just before, when you had political refugees. You are in a world where you have more than 7 billion people. It's not 2 billion people like 80 years ago. So it's a complex problem, because if you open the doors, it's the end of the world that people are used to living. And it's a very special world. It's the first time since the Roman Empire that people live in peace in Europe. 70 years of peace in Europe. And the Roman Empire was protected by walls, you know. You had walls around in order to prevent. So it's complex. Historically, it's very complex, and you have to manage to have, like Merkel did in Germany, 1 million people
in
a few months arriving in Germany. So now the extreme right, which was 2%, now it's 17% immediately. So you have to wait everything and to be reasonable. And of course, the way of each country in Europe making borders again, it's a catastrophe. So you have to keep the unity of the European Union, and the fact that
Mr. Trump decided, you know.
Great Britain left Europe is also a catastrophe in a way. Perhaps it will help Europe to make, how to say, unity politically.
Stronger politically.
It's unity, but it's not sure at all. So we are in an uncertain world. We don't know exactly what will happen, like it happened in the 20s. In the 20s, Hitler had 12 members of the parliament in 1928, and in 1930, 100, and in 1933, 300. So now we are in a world where we don't know at all what will happen. Marine Le Pen in France can be elected president. She is 25%. The left is perhaps 25%. The right, classical right, is also perhaps 25%. So with 25% or 30%, perhaps you can be elected. Who knows? And everywhere in Europe, you have that stream of populist vote and populist feelings and refusal of massive immigration. So how to stop a massive immigration and to let refugees went inside, and it's complicated. It's very complicated. You need international cooperation and a defense of values, and so I cannot advise.
United States.
You have the problem.
Can I turn to this gentleman in the back here? Yes, please.
Yes. Yes. Good evening. Je vais poser ma question en anglais. I'll ask my question in English. I have a few questions, but I have just one. So that pass the microphone on. For reasons of life expectancy, the hunt for Nazis is coming to an end or has come to an end. Could you talk about your activities currently and the future activities of your foundation?
Beate?
No, the question of Nazi criminals, it's over, you know. We stopped for a long time after the trial of Barbie, the trial in Cologne. And then Serge was also in charge of taking to jail those who had the French collaborators, as Leguet, Papon. So we finished with this. Today in Germany, you know, at this time when the Nazi criminals were still in their functions alive and lived openly, the German political society didn't want to judge them. As I said, you know, when I was in Germany, I remember from my, as I said before, for my parents, the fine was the communist, and so long, you know, there was nothing they didn't want. There was first the Nürnberger trial, then was the Eichmann trial, but in Germany there were very few one, and even the Auschwitz trial was, when you see how the judges treated the witnesses. So this happened nothing, some small trials. But then finally, there's a new society, and there was for 3 years a trial against a waiter in Auschwitz, Sobibor, Demjanjuk, who was, and they changed the law in Germany, because until then you had to be personally culpable, you know, that you can prove that he had been there. So then they changed this with Demjanjuk. It was enough that he has been in the camp during when the Jews were killed.
At Treblinka, right?
And he was in Sobibor, I think.
Sobibor.
So he was sentenced to, I think, 6 years, but he died before, and Karlsruhe didn't confirm. There was now, again, there had been some others in Germany, but you know, today there are 95 years old. They had been at this in the place. Very few refused even to answer. Someone, Gröning, who he was sent also to 3 or 4 years. And for the first time, the Karlsruhe confirmed that it was a good. The trial was the sentence was justified. But you know, it's just a symbolic act that still today there is a new generation, there are new judges. because the judges never had been independent, you know, because to have the trial in Cologne, it was the work of the sons and daughters, the victims who pushed the justice to do the trial. But today it's just a symbolic action. So I think Ludwigsburg, the center where they collect all the files, are looking for 3 or 4 or 5 more. Sometimes they don't find them or they are still die. It's just a symbolic action that says the German New Society wants to bring them to justice. Also, when the survivors come to testify for the German youth, it's good perhaps to have, because people coming from the survivors tell what happened to them. It's the positive side, but in order to bring them to justice, there's no more, I think, necessity.
And I wanted to say that our activities, I organize the memory in France of the Holocaust. I am one of the organizers. I am in the Council of Administration of the Foundation for the Memory of the Shoah, Memorial of the Memory of the Shoah, the Camp des Mille, the Camp of Rivesaltes, yeah. Memorial, all the memorials in France, I'm inside. And so
the work of memory goes on.
It's organized because we are creating memorials like in Drancy, in Les Mille, in Rivesaltes, huge memorials and interesting memorials and pedagogical memorials. And so that's work which takes time. Like Beate told you, Nazi criminals is behind us since 15 years ago. And Beate, we are ambassadors of UNESCO for the education to the history of Holocaust and prevention of genocide. So Beate went to Burundi to try to appeal to be more peaceful than, because there are many killings there. And Beate made a speech of the United Nations like last year in New York and last week in
Brussels,
European Parliament in Brussels. So we try to be active, but we start to be young, and the photo you cannot recognize so much.
Totally. No, I knew you in an instant when we met tonight. I think we have time for two more questions. Lady here, and then I'll come over here. Go ahead, stand up if you would. Yes. You.
Were you also involved in the documentation of the deportation of the Belgium children?
Yes.
Or just in France?
Belgian.
Belgium.
There were many Belgian children in France. And so in the memorial, which our friend Peter Hellman brought from his home on the 116 or 15 Street and Riverside Drive. So you have, there is another book, that's the first book, and there is a second one like that. You have 5,000 photos of the 11,000 children who were deported from France. Each one has a file, each one has his birth certificate and so on. And
For Belgium
and
also?
In Belgium they published also a book about Jewish children. And
we brought, you know, as for France, we brought the two responsible for, who are active in Belgium in the deportation
yes,
of the
and,
Jews,
Ilas
and
during
Asher.
5 years, we made a campaign in order to have Ernst Ehlers, who was a head colonel, SS colonel, with Einsatzgruppen, and then he came to be the head of the Nazi police in Belgium. And we could obtain his trial, and at the eve of the trial, he killed himself in order to escape the trial.
But
and Kurt Asche, who was the envoyé of Eichmann in Belgium, was sentenced in a trial in Kiel, which takes place during 6 months, I had to go to the north of
Germany. Our friends went to Germany.
So we did a lot for Belgium. Beate went with a commando of young Belgians to the north of where Ehlers, the former colonel of the Einsatzgruppe and head of the Nazi police in Belgium, was a judge in the administrative tribunal of Schleswig-Holstein. And in the same building, there was an investigation open against Ernst Ehlers. And the judge who had the file in hands knew well Ehlers, who was in the same building, and he told, I never made a rapprochement between the two.
Let me take one last question here, because then we have to stop. Gentlemen here. Just speak up, if you would, and I'll repeat
it. I wanted to ask you my final thing about bravery and danger, whether that is ever a consideration in what you've done. I mean, I know that under so many circumstances, you have been threatened, you've been attacked. In Bolivia, where I was born, actually, where my parents were Jewish refugees in Bolivia, there were so many Nazis that you were definitely in danger. Are any of these ever a consideration in your activity? How do you deal with it?
It's a terrific question. You went to Damascus in search of Brunner.
But we were very lucky concerning threats and attempts, because we had a bomb who killed somebody else, but a bomb which, un colis piégé, I don't know who heard it. So if I would open 1 centimeter, all killed.
Yes.
We had a bomb, our car exploded, but not in time, not in the morning when I took our girl to school. The school. And Beate was arrested many times in Syria.
We were in Beirut during the civil war
in order to help Jewish hostages in Beirut. And Beate went first. She was 1 month in the Muslim sector. And so everything could happen with her. I went to denounce the fact that they killed some hostages. And at the arrival, the journalist told me, you will never get epic to the hotel. Yeah. And
How do you, to return to that
but
last
we
question?
Don't, we did not fear, because we were on mission, you know. And when you are on mission, you hope to succeed in your mission, and you don't fear. And when a bomb arrives like that, what to do? You know, in a great city, you cannot escape. If somebody would be just in front of us with a gun, we could only wish a banana would be.
I just, as we close tonight, I want to read something that moved me very deeply from the book, and I sent to my own wife. It was some words that Serge sent to you when you two were first courting, as we say in English. I'll quickly translate them into English. A little courage, good humor, energy, and attachment to humanity, and a great deal of poetry to transfigure this life we live and lift it to the level of an exalting experience. I can't imagine a better motto to live by. And I thank both of you, Serge.
Thank you.